Holy King, comfort of the Spirit of Truth, who are ever present and fill us all things, treasure of blessings and giver of life, come and abide with us and close us for our impurities and our souls, O good one. One thing I would suggest is it's a good idea to bring a Bible with you when you come to the, because it is a Bible study per se. So it's kind of, your listening is good, but you can always bring it up on your. So we spent a long time on chapter 6. The Bread of Life discourse, kind of the main thing. So let's start reading through chapter 7. After this, Jesus went about in Galilee. He would not go about in Judea because the Jews sought to kill him. Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. So his brothers said to him, "Leave here and go to Judea, that your disciples may see the works you are doing. For no man works in secret if he seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world." For even his brothers did not believe in him. Jesus said to them, "My time has not yet come, but your time is always here. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify that its works are evil. Go to the feast yourselves. I'm not going up to this feast, for my time has not yet fully come." So saying, he remained in Galilee. But after his brothers had gone up to the feast, then he went up, not publicly, but in private. The Jews were looking for him at the feast and saying, "Where is he?" And there was much muttering about him among the people. While some said, "He is a good man," others said, "No, he is leading the people astray." Yet for fear of the Jews, no one spoke openly of him. About the middle of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. The Jews marveled at it, saying, "How is it that this man has learning when he has never studied?" So Jesus answered them, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. If any man's will is to do his will, he shall know whether the teaching is from God or whether I am speaking on my own authority. He who speaks on his own authority seeks his own glory, but he who seeks the glory of him who sent him is true, and in him there is no falsehood. Did not Moses give you the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Why do you seek to kill me?" The people answered, "You have a demon who is seeking to kill you." Jesus answered them, "I did one deed, and you all marvel at it. Moses gave you circumcision, not that it is from Moses, but from the fathers. And you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. If on the Sabbath a man receives circumcision so that the law of Moses may not be broken, are you angry with me because on the Sabbath I made a man's whole body well? Do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment." Some of the people of Jerusalem therefore said, "Is not this the man whom they seek to kill? And here he is speaking openly, and they say nothing to him. Can it be that the authorities really know that this is the Christ? Yet we know where this man comes from, and when the Christ appears, no one will know where he comes from." So Jesus proclaimed as he taught in the temple, "You know me and you know where I come from, but I have not come of my own accord. He who sent me is true, and him you do not know. I know him, for I come from him, and he sent me." So they sought to arrest him, but no one laid hands on him, because his hour had not yet come. Yet many of the people believed in him. They said, "When the Christ appears, he will do more signs, or will he do more signs than this man has?" The Pharisees heard the crowd thus muttering about him, and the chief priests and the Pharisees sent officers to arrest him. Jesus then said, "I shall go with you a little longer, and then I go to him who sent me. Will you seek me, and you will not find me? Where I am, you cannot come." The Jews said to one another, "Where does this man intend to go that we shall not find him? Does he intend to go to the dispersion among the Greeks and teach the Greeks? What does he mean by saying, you will seek me and you will not find me, and where I am, you cannot come? And we'll stop there.
Just curious what version you're using.
This is the RSV. What do you have?
Well, I can flip to any version on the phone, but the King James. This is, and it says Greeks versus Gentiles in the King James.
Yeah, it's... I'm not sure what the Greek word is.
No, I'm saying in that version it says, are you going to go among the Greeks? Versus in here it says, are you going to go among the Gentiles?
Right, but I wonder what the original says.
Yeah.
The Alenes would be the Greeks, but it also means the pagans.
Pagans and the pagans would be probably.
Which is Gentiles.
I have a Greek Bible somewhere at home.
So do I. Yeah. I just didn't bring it with me.
Is there one here?
No.
No, not here.
No, this library...
It's Russian.
It's mostly Russian with a little bit of English. And it needs... Well, it needs a little bit more English. And it needs another 5,000 square feet, so. But where would you put that on this lot? I don't know.
Skyscraper.
Yeah. So, okay, let's go back to verse 1 and start a kind of commentary. After this, Jesus went about in Galilee. He would not go about in Judea because the Jews sought to kill him. Now, the Jews' feast of Tabernacles was at hand. Now, what's interesting is that chapter 7, takes place a year after chapter 6 and chapter 5. Because chapter 5 was the Feast of Tabernacles, and when Jesus healed on the Sabbath. And so Jesus was in Galilee during this time. And it's interesting how in the Gospel of St. John, what you've got are like these snapshots. The Gospel of St. John is really only a few days in the life of Jesus' ministry. It's not this comprehensive picture of everything that he did and when. Of course, that would be too much. But it's... And the other Gospels... You know, they have a little bit more of that kind of detail. Not much, but a bit more. Whereas with John, you have, it's pretty focused on a few very specific kind of key periods.
So it was a year after, but how long before the Passion was it? Do we know?
I don't know.
Okay.
So this would have been the fall. The Tabernacles is like...
That makes sense, yeah.
Beginning of September, about this time of year.
Yeah.
So they have the Day of Atonement and then the Passover. And then the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, Feast of Tabernacles is something that's quite interesting. There are two different versions from the Old Testament. The first level, Elizabeth.
Yes?
Don't go away.
Oh, I have to leave at 8 o'clock.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, no, I thought that the time actually started at 7.
Ah.
So I think I've been here for a while.
Okay. Did you give Andre your information?
I did, just right now.
Okay, good.
So thank you
and,
so much.
And if you need to get a hold... You need to get a hold of me so we can talk about...
Yes. Thank
okay.
You.
You can get it from him.
Okay,
thanks. The first celebration of Tabernacles was the consecration of the first temple. And it was Solomon coming to the temple and and consecrating the temple, and that was the first layer. And tabernacles, the Feast of Tabernacles, referred to the tabernacle in the wilderness, which then was put into a more solid form with the building of the temple. Then there's another layer on top of that, which is the commemoration of the the actual giving of the law, isn't it?
No, that's Simchat Torah. That's a different celebration.
Okay, what's tabernacle?
But the tabernacle would be, what you mentioned, but then also it's a commemoration of the 40 years in the desert.
Right.
And so they built temporary shelters like their ancestors did in the desert to remember that period of time. Yeah. Well, but then follow shortly after that, I think, after the Feast of Tabernacles is the giving of the revelation at Sinai.
Yeah.
That's a separate. So people would make these booths, in commemoration.
Mm-hmm. And that's on the popular level. And on the liturgical level in the temple, what's very interesting is that on each day of the feast, and it was a 7 or 8 day feast, there would be processions, and people would carry palm branches, and the priests would carry water from the pool of Siloam into the temple. And so there was this whole connection with a festal entry into the temple. There is a whole connection with water. And so if you keep these things in mind, there is a connection with certainly because one of the other things that was done liturgically was that the law was read aloud. I don't know if it was the whole Torah or if it was like Deuteronomy or what, but the law was read aloud. And so there was this not only a proclamation of the law, but then there was also discussion of the law among the people. So it was all of these things together. Of course, the processions were very festal and they were kind of dancing,
Wasn't there also, isn't this one of the pilgrim festivals, wasn't it tied also to an agricultural festival?
Right.
To a harvest, and that would be an even older...
Right.
I don't want to say pre-religious, but...
Well, it would have been... the earliest level would have been a harvest festival.
A harvest.
Or the beginning of the harvest, or something like that. But it's a harvest festival. Then there's the commemoration of the tabernacle in the wilderness and the consecration of the temple. Then there was the proclamation of the law. And then then people took that home, as it were, and what they did is they would build these little huts, little booths. And it's interesting, you go to Brooklyn, to certain sections of Brooklyn, and on all the fire escapes, because it's an Orthodox Jewish area, on all the fire escapes you see these little palm booths where people go, and that's where they eat. They eat in these.
And I think there's supposed to be certain fruits as well as palms.
Yeah,
but
I don't...
There's certain fruits associated with with this, but that probably is from the older agricultural. Mm-hmm. It's all sort of, those layers are there.
Yeah. Yeah, most
Lulav
of...
and an etrog.
What's that?
Lulav and etrog. And there's the palm frond, and then there's a little fruit, type of fruit that they have.
Mm-hmm. But so you've got all these commemorations, and in particular from that oldest level of the Lord, of the king, who actually was the representative, kind of the icon of God, coming into his temple. and so the presence of God going into the temple. And so think about what happened on Palm Sunday. So people thought it was a tabernacles kind of procession, because they had palms and branches and they were going in procession, and they were receiving the king who was coming into the temple. Mm-hmm. Palm Sunday doesn't talk so much about water, but Jesus does a little bit later on in the chapter. So one of the things that's important is to have an idea of what was going on liturgically in Judaism, both in the first temple and later on in the second temple, because things changed. The liturgy changed. It had undergone this very great kind of reform. Okay. Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. So his brothers said to him, "Leave here." Okay, all Jewish men were supposed to go to Jerusalem for the feast. "Leave here and go to Judea, that your disciples may see the works that you are doing. For no man works in secret if he seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world." For even his brothers did not believe in him. Okay, who are Jesus' brothers? In a couple places they're enumerated, but James is the chief among them, and there was Joseph and others, and the church understands them to be sons of Joseph by his previous marriage, his previous wife or wives, and thus they were quite a bit older than Jesus, because Joseph was already an old man when he received Mary, and so essentially it says that his brothers were skeptical of him, you know, looking at their little brother and wondering, well, who is, you know, where is this coming from? Jesus said to them, "My time has not yet come, but your time already is." I don't think that probably went over too well. "The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify of it that its works are evil. Go to the feast yourselves. I'm not going up to this feast, for my time has not yet fully come." So saying, he remained in Galilee. One of the scholars posits that they went up to Jerusalem both for the Day of Atonement, and then which was followed quickly by Tabernacles, so that his brothers went up for the Day of Atonement, but he didn't go up until the Feast of Tabernacles, and there was enough time between them for him to go, and he didn't go making a big show with his disciples, but rather tried to be very discreet. Yeah.
Is there a reason why this sounds very similar to Joseph and his brothers?
Of course. There's always a pair. There are always typological parallels. That would be an interesting thing to pull apart.
I had never seen it before until just now when you were talking about James and his older brothers.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a parallel. It's certainly not an exact typological one. It's not like they threw him in a pit and sold him off to slave traders. But certainly there's an analogy can be drawn. One of the things that the church absolutely believes is in the perpetual virginity of the Mother of God. That she remained a virgin her entire life. That she never had sexual relations. She never had another child other than Jesus. again, Joseph was an old man and probably died fairly soon, while Jesus was fairly young.
And you can stay virgin if you have a baby.
Yeah, I was going to ask it same question.
It's against the theology.
But that's the dogma of the church.
What's the bigger miracle, maintaining virginity or having God in the womb?
Right. I mean, she can't have a baby unless you have sexual relations. So
she had the baby, so
obviously if she had the baby, then she can stay a virgin, because anything is possible with God. Anything is possible, right?
Yeah. But the doctrine of the church says she was a virgin before, during, and after the birth of Jesus.
We need to know what means virgin.
You have to
it certainly means that she's
not a logical term.
Yeah, it certainly means that she never had any sexual relations with a man. That's certainly what it means. On one level, on a physical level, on a spiritual level, it means that her soul remained absolutely pure and undefiled by any kind of passion, and that. And she never gave herself over to carnal passion. She essentially was received into Joseph's house, where there were all these previous sons of Joseph, so some of whom were probably older than her. One of the things I was having this conversation with Peter Gardner, who had already done most of the homework and has now put together a little book detailing the kinship structure around Jesus.
Interesting.
Who were his brothers? Which ones were apostles? What relationship did the apostles have to Jesus? You know, many of them were related. It's quite interesting. I'm looking forward to the manuscript. Seeing the manuscript. Okay. So Jesus says, "My time has not yet come, but your time is always here." Now, he said that previously to his mother. Remember, at the wedding in Cana, "My time has not yet come." Mm-hmm. And yet he went and did the miracle, the sign anyway. So he's saying to them, "My time has not yet come, but your time is always here. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify of it that its works are evil." The world is a very important category in the writing, in the Gospel of St. John, and in the first epistle of St. John. And the world has two different meanings. On one hand, you've got the world meaning the creation. And he's not saying that the creation is evil, but rather the other meaning of the world, which means the complex of relationships defined by human passions. Okay. And that's what's evil.
Thank you for that clarification.
Yeah. So St. John says in his first epistle, "All that is in the world is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life." And that's evil. Mm-hmm. When he says, "The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify of its works, and its works are evil." Well, those are works of evil. The creation is not evil. And this is very important.
God created it.
God created it, but there's been a very strong movement in certain parts of Christian history, especially in the West, and especially thought influenced by Gnosticism, to say that the material world is evil and that the spiritual is good, and that all that is of the world is evil, all that is of the flesh is evil, and all that is of the that is spiritual is good, and so we have to escape the world, the creation, and the flesh, and live only according to the spiritual. That's one variation. Or there's another variation which says because the works of the material world and the flesh are evil, it doesn't matter what you do with that. You can do anything you want because we're not of that world. We're of the spiritual world. So eat, drink, and be merry, and and have fun because it was really not relevant, and because that's not really who you are. Well, the church rejects both of these dualistic kind of attitudes towards the material world.
So what's evil? What's evil?
Yeah. What's evil is this complex of sins and passions that create a kind of a false world. A complex within society of people acting according to sin.
But is it not spiritual also?
Well, yeah, it's both spiritual and material.
But then you said spiritual was good.
And evil
is included in the spiritual.
Well, in Christian understanding, in Orthodox understanding, God created the material world to be good. And the material world is suffused with and embodies also the spiritual world. The two are together, and you can't separate them. It's this false duality or dualism that says the spiritual is good and the material is evil. That is what the church rejects. Now, the word world is used both for the material creation in gospel, in the writings of St. John. The word, the world, or cosmos, is used both for the material world, but also it has a completely different sense in this, set of interrelations that are defined by sin and the passions. Two different meanings, totally different meanings. Of this concept.
All sins are evil. It's not me, it's evil.
Yeah, sins are evil. But when he uses the word the works of the world are evil, he's not referring to the material creation. He's referring to this whole kind of network of social interactions that are defined by sin. And that's what's evil. So does it make sense? It's the same word, unfortunately, but different meanings.
So even the most ascetic hermits don't view the comfort of a bed as evil? Or fine cloth as...
Not if they're balanced.
Right, okay.
It's not that it's evil, no.
Then why did they sleep on boards? Or yes, the ground or nothing?
Because it's a discipline. So that they don't become attached to the comfort.
Because it would be comfortable to lay
down. Yeah, it's not that the fine cloth or the nice mattress or the good food or whatever it is evil in and of itself. It's rather our attitude towards it.
Oh, so they were saving themselves from that passion.
Right.
It's part of their fast, right?
It's part of their fast.
But there's no underlying belief as in these other systems that were of thought that it's evil. Right?
Well, yeah, in Manichaean kind of Gnosticism, which became very, there was a very strong Gnostic and Manichaean element, especially in Augustine. And so you had people that went off balance. And so they would say that these material things were evil. And they're not. And that which the church rejects. Now, you know, and material things are basically neutral. I mean, they're not.
They're not intrinsically evil.
They're not intrinsically evil.
Or inevitably good.
Right. It depends on how you use them. And if you make a god out of them, if you think, I can't live without the Armani sweater, or the Ferrari or the BMW or the.
Or the iPhone.
But the iPhone and the Ferrari aren't the evil things. It's the I can't live without them that is
right.
Evil.
But yeah, so it's our attitude towards them.
Yes.
And it's the same thing with money. You have some, you know, there's the saying in the scriptures, money is the root of all evil. Well, it's not money itself, it's the love of money is the root of all evil. Mm-hmm. Money is not evil. It's neutral. It's what's your attitude towards it, and do you possess it or does it possess you? Mm-hmm. And same thing with any other kind of material things. Now, obviously, one of the things I think that Jesus is referring to is talking about the works of the world being evil, is that there are people who want to kill him. So, which is definitely evil, right? Mm-hmm. So, he's just saying, okay, guys, this is the reality, you know? And so to not recognize that as evil would be problematic, to say the least.
So, Ladiga, he's basically foretelling his death right there. My time has not come.
Right.
Correct?
Correct.
So he knows he's going to die, and he's mm-hmm. trying to explain that.
Right.
But in very.
Mm-hmm. Well, and he talks about. Glancing at the text on the previous chapter, in verse 51 of chapter 6. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. Well, he obviously knew he was going to die, and you know. But remember, this text was written long after his passion. This text was written 60 years later. So it's the product of decades of reflection on Christ's life and words and teachings and actions. So it's not like John was sitting there with a pen, you know,
as it was happening,
or any of the other evangelists either. There probably were some people who took notes. People had better memories because they were trained to remember things in a way that we're not anymore.
Oral tradition
and. And people paid better attention. They weren't confined to the 30-second soundbite.
I had a neighbor like that in Miami. He died in 1999, but he grew up in a rural village in Cuba, and there were no telephone, radio, TV, and the people that had status were people that could tell stories. But he had tremendous, like, he only had a sixth grade education, but he could recollect details of, and he had stories that were passed down, and then he kind of like had like, it was amazing. He could describe dialogues and,
mm-hmm.
but that was his life.
Was it a big deal for Jesus to die?
Well, yeah.
Why? You know where he was going? I mean, he was going back to his
territory. Okay, hold on to that question.
Okay.
Okay.
Pour me something.
It is kind of a big deal when people are trying to kill you, and especially the leaders of your nation. Now, when he's referring to the Jews, he's not referring to all Hebrew people. He's referring to first to this group that came back from the exile and brought Judaism with them back from Babylon, where it had taken its shape during the exile, because the religion of the first temple had been obliterated when the first temple was obliterated, and the priesthood and the sacrifices and all of that, and all of the sacred things in the temple had disappeared, and there was no longer kingship in Israel with the second temple, or with the end of the first temple, so the whole religion had to morph, and did, and it morphed during the time of Josiah's reforms, called the Deuteronomic reforms. One of the aspects of that was a new prominence given to Moses, that was not as present in the religion of the first temple as it would be in the second temple. It's like another layer was added to the tradition during that time, and so when he refers to the Jews being disciples of Moses and keeping the law of Moses, what he's referring to is that there's this new layer on top of the ancient layer of the tradition from the first temple. And all this comes up in the dialogue here. Verse 10. After his brothers had gone up to the feast, he also went up, but not publicly, but in private. The Jews were looking for him at the feast and saying, "Where is he?" And there was much muttering about him among the people. While some said, "He's a good man," others said, "No, he's leading the people astray." Yet for fear of the Jews, no one spoke openly of him. In other words, he's not, for fear of the Jews doesn't mean anti-Semitism, okay? It doesn't mean anything like that. It means for fear of the leaders of this particular sect. There was one sect within broader Hebrew religion. Of course, it was the one that was in charge.
Just going back a little bit. When he said, "My time is not yet come, but your time is always ready." What is that second part?
Well, what he's saying, his time is governed by, essentially governed by the Father, as to how the economy of salvation will unfold in his life. In other words, there's a time when for him to come out publicly, and it's not yet. Whereas with the others, they don't have any such kind of timing given to them as to what they're doing. Also, his message is a message of condemning the sinful content of worldly interaction. His brothers, on the other hand, and he essentially is kind of sticking it to his brothers, are saying, "Your interactions are you're of the world," and he's saying, "I'm not of the world. You're of the time of this world, and I'm my time, and my time is the time of the other world, is the time of the kingdom." So does this make sense? Okay. About the middle of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. The Jews marveled at it, saying, "How is it that this man has learning when he has never studied?" So Jesus answered them, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me." Okay, one of the things that we don't know, and there's a lot that we don't know about Jesus, is what happened during those 12 years, or those almost 20 years between his going up to the temple with his parents when he was 12 years old, and he stayed back and was questioning the teachers, and Mary and Joseph went back to find him and, you know, and collect him, and he said, I must be about my father's business. We don't know anything about the years that, between that and when he was 30 and went to John the Baptist in the wilderness. The scriptures don't say anything. The tradition really doesn't say anything.
But yet they're saying he's unlearned.
They're saying
the indication that he...
Right. In other words, that he didn't go to a recognized... belonged to a recognized school. He hadn't studied formally, but he obviously knew and understood everything. Now, there's all sorts of speculation, you know, and you got some people who say, oh, he went off to India and he became a guru there, and, you know, and all of that stuff, you know, or to Tibet, and then others that he was just, you know, he stayed home and was a carpenter, others, and would work around, you know, just living life as an ordinary Israelite in Galilee.
But there's no about his life?
Nothing. With any authority. Mm. And that's rather interesting. But obviously, he did know the scriptures. And he knew certain books very well, and those are the ones that he cites in particular as bearing witness to him, Book of Isaiah in particular. But he also has a rather, a rather deep understanding of the scriptures and of what and how the scriptures were constituted, and I'm wondering what kind of discussion there was at the time about the correction of books,
and who was
which was happening.
Who was teaching?
And who was teaching? Remember, there was no such thing as a monolithic Judaism. Mm-hmm. There was no such thing as Orthodox Judaism. There were a dozen different sects. The Jews, consisting of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and, you know, who were the disciples of Moses, and then there were the Essenes, who were from the first temple priesthood, and then there were the Zealots who wanted to rebel against the Romans, and on and on and on, and some of them, like the Pharisees and the priests collaborated with the Romans, and some of them hated the Romans and were continually agitating against them and creating all sorts of problems and all sorts of... So there were these individual rabbis who had groups of disciples, and they would go around the countryside and they would teach in the synagogues. And Jesus was one of these wandering rabbis with a group of disciples who followed him.
That's when he grew up.
Well, that's when he began his ministry.
Yeah.
Because he didn't begin his ministry until he was 30 years old.
Exactly. So by the time when he was taught, who was teaching?
Well, that's the question.
Great question.
And that we don't know.
He could have been working as well, and because many people then worked and then they still studied. It wasn't incompatible with life.
Mm-hmm. Although there were very few people who were literate.
What's that?
There were very few people who were literate.
Yeah, that's where the whole idea of amen came, because that means I agree, because not everyone could read, so
right.
But they could listen, and mm-hmm. then they would say amen, they would agree, so they could still participate.
Federico, forgive me. You mentioned scripture.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but the scriptures weren't written until 60 years, you just said, later. So, what...
The New Testament was... The Gospel of St. John probably wasn't written until about 90.
So, you're referring to the Old Testament when you say scriptures?
Well,
he knew the scriptures, so he knew...
He knew the Old Testament.
Okay.
He couldn't.
Because the old
he
testament
could
know
the
was
New
Jewish.
Testament.
Right.
Well, he knew it, but it wasn't written. He didn't know how it was. Yeah. He was
no.
actually living it.
He
right.
was living it.
He was the New Testament.
He was the New Testament.
And you know, and the synagogues.
Okay. Because it all refers back to the Jews.
Well, it refers back. It refers back to the prophets, the law and the prophets, and the
right.
Psalms and the.
Okay.
The historical books, and so. The synagogues would have had some of these books.
Okay.
Maybe not all of them. And that's a, you know, if it was a very rich synagogue that, remember the books had to be copied by hand.
Yeah, they don't have
and they came back from Babylon and maybe they didn't have much coming back.
Well, no, actually the books came out, were put together in Babylon.
Oh, they were put together.
Yeah, because they had no other religious, you know, and it was all the intelligentsia who were deported to Babylon, and so they took the sacred books with them. And
excuse me, didn't they have tablets in those days?
No.
No, already books?
There were scrolls, mainly scrolls.
From what papyrus?
Either papyrus or vellum.
Mm-hmm. So they
goat skins.
Yeah.
Goat skin is very durable.
Yes.
Interesting.
And so what happened in Babylon is that, you know, they had no temple, they had no sacrifices, they had no priests, they had no they couldn't do the services like they knew them from the temple, so they had to come up with a whole new religion that didn't have priests, it didn't have sacrifices, it didn't have a temple, it didn't have any sacramental kind of content. Last week we talked about the whole sacramental content of Judaism, right? That the bread and the wine of the showbread, the cereal offering, became the sacrament of essentially of communion, as it was consecrated in the temple and then eaten by the priests, that the high priest was the sacrament of the presence of the Lord in the second temple. In the first temple, it was the king who was the sacrament of the presence of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, like we say, referred to either the high priest or to the king, who went into the Holy of Holies, and one of his garments was a crown with the name of God written on it. And so he was in the name of the Lord. He comes in the person of the Lord, bearing the name of the Lord on his forehead. And what did he do in the Holy of Holies? He pronounced the name of the Lord, which was otherwise unpronounceable. There was a big difference between the first temple and its ritual and the second temple and its ritual, because there was a lot that couldn't be reconstructed. There's only one Ark of the Covenant, and it disappeared before the exile. There was no king, and there was one of the things that it appears was omitted from some of the manuscripts, but is present in other texts, is that in the center of the Holy of Holies was the throne of the king. But with no king, there was no throne, and. Since there was no Ark of the Covenant in the Second Temple, and what was in there was empty. So
they had like a new religion.
It was like a new religion.
It was kind of like
Protestantism coming into a Catholic country. It's like the religion of the first temple was like Catholicism. And then you got these, all the intelligentsia were carried off into Babylon for 70 years, which is what, three generations. And then they come back and they have this whole new religion. It's like Protestantism came into Europe, into Catholic Europe, and the Catholics said, well, what is this? But the Protestants looked at the Catholics and said, well, what is this? So it was two very different approaches.
They even had a new language, right?
And it was a new language. Oh. Because Hebrew ceased to be...
They were foreigners.
Well, yeah, Hebrew ceased to be used. Mm-hmm. And what the predominant language was Aramaic. Yeah, yeah. And so only the priests could read the Hebrew, or the rabbis, and the common people didn't understand it. We wouldn't know anything about that, right? A sacred language that nobody understands.
Yeah, that's a mystery. That's good.
Yeah. So,
refer to Latin.
Well, in the Roman Church, how about Slavonic? The Russians don't understand Slavonic.
They don't.
Some of it.
Some of it. That's right.
Easier to listen in English.
Yeah.
And pray.
Right. There's a song about laying aside the cookies, right? What lajim po pechenia.
Я крокодил перед тобой.
So.
That's Владыка used to say that.
Okay. So let's move on. Verse 16. So Jesus answered them, my teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. If any man's will is to do his will, in other words, if many, and who is it that sent Jesus? The Father, right? Mm-hmm. So this is all, and this whole thing is in the context of the question is, where is Jesus from? And the people are thinking, well, he's from Nazareth. In other words, he's from Podunk, you know? And there's no prophet from Podunk, just like there's no prophet from Nazareth. Or even Galilee, except for Jonah. So the Jews are saying, "Well, we know this guy's from Nazareth, and there's nothing supposed to come out of Nazareth. I mean, what's Nazareth?" But they don't understand that when Jesus is saying that he comes from the Father, that he comes from God. So Jesus answered them, my teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. If any man's will is to do his will, he shall know whether the teaching is from God or whether I am speaking on my own authority. He who speaks on his own authority seeks his own glory, but he who seeks the glory of him who sent him is true, and in him there is no falsehood. Did not Moses give you the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Why do you seek to kill me? The people answered, you have a demon. Who is seeking to kill you? Jesus answered them, I did one deed, and you all marvel at it. Now, this is referring to, back to chapter 5, the healing of the man on the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. And this is a year later, and they're still upset that Jesus healed a man on the Sabbath, because it caused a big controversy.
He didn't do anything in between?
We don't know what he did in between. Jesus answered them, I did one deed and you all marvel at it. Moses gave you circumcision, not that it is from Moses, but from the fathers. Now, there's a gentle little polemic in there. It's interesting. Moses gave you circumcision, not that it is from Moses, but from the fathers. And you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. If on the Sabbath a man receives circumcision so that the law of Moses may not be broken, are you angry with me because on the Sabbath I made a man's whole body well? Do not judge by appearances, but judge with righteous judgment. So he's drawing an analogy. If you circumcise somebody to be in obedience to the law on the Sabbath, why not do something even greater for the health of the whole person also on the Sabbath? It's on the same level, he's saying. And this is a type of rabbinic argument, evidently.
You know, it was going on then, and that it wasn't settled. The Sabbath was considered, well, other than the Day of Atonement, was holier, but mm-hmm. the Sabbath was sacred, not just space, time, not to be desecrated, a gift. It was to be, not people, not work. But then they were trying to say, well, what is work? There were a lot of things that weren't worked out.
Mm-hmm. Right.
There were different ideas
mm-hmm.
floating around, and people arguing about it,
right.
and fighting about it, and
mm-hmm.
maybe hitting each other or fighting. But then it finally got worked out. Like if you talk to someone who's Orthodox today, a Jew, they will say, someone's health is in danger. It doesn't matter if the Sabbath, get a car, go on the phone, get a doctor,
yeah.
a surgeon. Right. You don't put someone's life at risk to follow ritual.
Right.
Did they argue about it on the Sabbath?
That's the whole point. But yeah, but these things were
arguing is not work. Arguing is life.
It's called learning or whatever.
Could you pass the water, please?
But like if someone, but I think if I needed treatment for my acne, I don't think that would be maybe something.
No, probably not.
I could wait. But like anything that, like if people didn't have food, that like cut to get food or something, people can't starve and put their life in risk.
Right. Or the life of their animals.
Right. Or even to fast if they're going to die or, you know, you can't like... But some people were more extreme and they had all these.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. Thank you.
Do you think that's because of what happened in the New Testament with Christ? Or because he made people whole on the Sabbath? No. Or made them healthy? Made their bodies healthy? That there's no argument today?
I doubt that that was the source of their argument.
Yeah.
It was probably something that long predated Jesus anyway.
It's like modern day.
Oh, yeah. It's probably still going on from long before Jesus.
So what does he mean when judge not according to appearance? Is it Christ's appearance or whose appearance?
Well, in other words, according to external criteria. You know, okay, so yes, technically it appears that he violated the law by doing this miracle, this sign on the Sabbath. But it's only the appearance of a transgression. It's not really a transgression. But in other words, don't look on the surface, but look deeper. Look at the real content. So, are we clear on this? Okay. 25. Some of the people of Jerusalem therefore said, is not this the man whom they seek to kill? And here he is speaking openly, and they say nothing to him. Can it be that the authorities really know that this is the Christ? Yet we know where this man comes from, and when the Christ appears, no one will know where he comes from. Now, it's interesting that the Gospel of John does not bring up the fact that Jesus was actually born in Bethlehem, the city of David, of the stock of David. John doesn't mention that. The other Gospels, well, Matthew and Luke do. Mark doesn't. But here again, it's this whole polemic thing about, we know that Jesus comes from Nazareth, and so who is he to be doing these signs? So Jesus proclaimed as he taught in the temple, you know me and you know where I come from. Now, here it's phrased as a question. In Greek, when the New Testament was written, it was written in all capitals, without punctuation, and without spaces between the words. So, it was just lines of letters without spaces. So you'd have to really know And you have to kind of, and you catch the meaning by the inflection. So in English, of course, we interpolate the punctuation. We interpolate the inflection. So this version says, "So you know me and you know where I come from." You know, in a very kind of ironic way. Or as a question. Other versions have said, you know, just make it a statement. You know me and you know where I come from. In the Hebrew, because Jesus was speaking Aramaic, or in the original language, because Jesus was speaking Aramaic, not even Hebrew, it's not only written without spaces between the words, it's written without vowels. So you have to know it really well, and so most letters are three and four letter most words are three and four letter combinations. Of course, there's all sorts of different variations depending on which vowels you put in there, and the meanings can be very different. There's a very fine art to translating this kind of literature, especially from the ancient languages. To me, it seems like this interpretation, because it is an interpretation, that Jesus is asking a question. So, do you know me and you know where I come from, huh? Is a legitimate interpretation. But I have not come of my own accord. He sent me is true, and him you do not know. I know him, for I come from him, and he sent me. So they sought to arrest him, but no one laid hands on him, because his hour had not yet come. Yet many of the people believed in him. They said, when the Christ appears, will he do more signs than this man has done? So, Christ, you know, I'm sure that to them he was talking in riddles. You know me, so you think you know who I am and where I come from, but I really come from him who sent me and not of my own accord, and he who sent me is true, and him you do not know. Well, I'm sure they were really confused because they didn't have any idea of what he was referring to. And my guess is that they probably did not think that he was referring to God. But so far as what Jesus is teaching us, is that his very identity is as the Son of God. He comes from God. He comes to do the will of God. He's completely devoted to doing the will of God. He seeks only to do the will of God and not his own will. He is seeking to manifest and to glorify God and not himself. He's seeking to teach what God has given him to teach to the people. And he says, those who are faithful, those who are seeking to do the will of God, will hear and understand what he's doing. But those who are looking after their own selfish agenda, they won't understand. So, 32. The Pharisees heard the crowd thus muttering about him, and the chief priests and Pharisees sent officers to arrest him. Jesus then said, "I shall be with you a little longer, and then I go to him who sent me. You will seek me, and you will not find me. Where I am, you cannot come." The Jews said to one another, "Where does this man intend to go, that we shall not find him? Does he intend to go to the dispersion among the Greeks, and teach the Greeks? What does he mean by saying, 'You will seek me, and you will not find me, and where I am, you cannot come'?" Well, I think we all understand that what he's saying is that he will go to be enthroned at the right hand of the Father. He will pass through the death of the cross and resurrection to be enthroned at the right hand of the Father, and they can't come there. But there, and it's interesting that it's specifically the chief priests and the Pharisees. Now, the Pharisees, you know, were the core of the Jews, and the chief priests were Jews, you know, from the sect of the Jews, but they were also the ones in charge of the temple. And so there was, the Pharisees were in charge of the synagogues, and the chief priests were in charge of the temple. So they were the religious leaders. But they were the leaders of this particular sect of the Jews. And so they perceived that this Jesus, who was not, you know, doing all these signs, and who was even raising up the sick, and doing and daring to do so on the Sabbath, and arguing with them about the interpretation of the law during the Feast of Tabernacles, which is what they did on the Feast of Tabernacles. They would argue about the interpretation of the law because the law was being read publicly. And who would it be who would be doing the proclamation and the interpretation of the law? It would be the Jews. It would be the chief priests and the Pharisees. And here was Jesus doing what they were supposed to be doing. And he was doing it with in a spirit of authority, whereas they were saying, and so-and-so said this, and so-and-so said that, and so-and-so said this, and so-and-so said that.
Let's get a clarification that may not be terribly important, but can you clarify why the Pharisees had the authority over the soldiers to tell them to go arrest?
Well, they were probably from the Sanhedrin, which was the highest council of the Jews, like the council of the religious leaders. So it would have been the leaders of the temple and the leaders of the main synagogues together in this council, and they controlled the temple guard. So this probably would have been the temple guard.
Oh, these would not be the Roman soldiers.
No, these would not be Roman soldiers. And you can. And then you can kind of, and you can see that a little bit later on. If you jump down to verse 45, the officers then went back to the chief priests and Pharisees, who said to them, "Why did you not bring him?" The officers answered, "No man ever spoke like this man." The Pharisees answered them, "Are you led astray also? Have any of the authorities or of the Pharisees believed in him? But this crowd who does not know the law are accursed." So, obviously they were Jews. Or they were, you know, they followed the sect of the Jews. And they were under the authority of the leaders. Now we go back to 35. It's kind of ironic that they ask, well, where is he going to go? Is he going to go into the diaspora among the Greeks? In other words, is he going to leave Israel, Palestine, Roman-occupied Palestine, and go off, you know, elsewhere into the Roman Empire? Because that's exactly what happens with the gospel. It went all over the dispersion, the diaspora.
I wanted to ask you a question, if I may. Mm-hmm. What's the difference between temple and synagogue?
It's a radical distinction. The temple is ultimately the place of sacrifice, and the understanding is that it's the dwelling place of the glory of God. There was only one temple in Jerusalem, built by, first one was built by Solomon, then it was destroyed and rebuilt in the second temple, and then that was destroyed in 70 AD. But it was the center of the entire life of the state, and the first temple was also the throne of the king. And remember, there was no, and they didn't have any idea of separation between church and state. I mean, it was a unified kind of society. And so the services that went on in the temple, you know, and especially with the second temple, there was this whole set of sacrifices that were done every day. Sacrifices of animals, and then people, you know, that were to mark the various times of day and things like that. And then sacrifice of incense, sacrifice of, or the offering of the bread and wine of the bread of the presence, and so forth. And so it was a sacramental kind of ministry. The people would offer animals in sacrifice, which were taken, which were offered their, they were killed and their blood taken, and it was offered to God, and part of the meat was given to the priests, but most of it was returned to the people who offered it, as a meal of sanctification.
Which wasn't done in synagogues.
No. In a synagogue, so the temple is the original form. Synagogues didn't appear until after the exile. Uh-huh. Synagogues were not, they were not, there were not temples. There was no sacrifices. There were no, it was a place of study and of meeting and discussion.
Not prayer.
And well, there was some prayer, but the worship of God was understood to be connected with the sacrifices. But there was common prayer together, and you know, the reading of psalms and things like that in the synagogue. But it was basically study of the script, the reading and the study of the scriptures, and the interpretation of the scriptures. And then the rabbis are not priests. Rabbis are scholars, there's no priestly content. In other words, no sacrificing content to a rabbinic ministry. It's just, you know, it's basically study, preaching, and teaching. And then I'm sure there's pastoral issues that, you know, that are involved as well. But, you know, there was no Jewish priesthood after the destruction of the Second Temple. So it's like the difference between the Orthodox Church and the Presbyterian Church. Big difference. Mm-hmm. And actually, the Presbyterians consciously modeled their church on the Jewish synagogue. Mm-hmm. 16th century Jewish synagogue, but Jewish synagogue.
Diga. Are the rabbis still members of the tribe of Levi, or
no.
Is it just any Jewish man who thought that he knew something could become a rabbi?
They got the education, right?
Yeah, who's educated?
That's like sanctification, just education.
Right, yeah. That's another thing. The priests in the temple all had to be of the tribe of Levi, and the high priest could only come from the sons of Aaron.
But nowadays Jews, they pray in synagogues, don't they?
Right, they pray, but they don't do any sacrifices because there are no priests. Now, there are many who many Jews. I'm sure everybody knows somebody named Cohen,
yes.
Right?
Common name.
Cohen, which is priest, in Hebrew. Since most Jews in America have no connection to Hebrews, but they're Khazars, Cohen may not be exactly a name in continuity with actual priestly descent. The name did survive, and there are those who can trace their ancestry back. Now, when the first temple was destroyed, all of the genealogical records were destroyed, so that they could no longer prove that they were a Kohen or that they were a son of Aaron. So that's one of the reasons why the period of the Second Temple, they rejected the priesthood, because it wasn't, they couldn't verify that the high priests were actually Aaronic priests.
So and it was, did, and it was, why did the Jews sacrifice now?
They don't.
The continuity is interrupted.
The continuity was interrupted. Except that if you follow the narrative, the priests, much of the priesthood, entered the church. So Orthodox Christianity is the continuity of...
You come from the apostles, you come.
Right, yeah. Right, but Judaism bifurcated, or the Hebrew religion bifurcated. Judaism, in other words, the religion of the Pharisees, survived. And that's what we have now as Rabbinic Judaism, which is what we think of as Judaism now. That survived. The other part of Judaism is Orthodox Christianity. Yeah.
But Dick, when you say that the lineages were destroyed, when the first temple destroyed, when Ezra and Nehemiah go through the list of the priests and they say, okay, you're good to be a priest, you're not good to be a priest, we're going to set you aside because you can't prove who you're from, was that all from word of mouth saying my father was so-and-so's father?
Right. And, you know, and but all the documents were destroyed. Because they had huge... I just looked at the Book of Numbers. And they kept genealogical records, you know. And so it's easy, you know, you read through the Book of Numbers and you get lost in the begats, you know. And so-and-so begat so-and-so and begat so-and-so who begat so-and-so who begat so-and-so. And these genealogical records are very important because in Judaism because they show that, especially for the Levitical and much less Aaronic line. No, it's one of the things that's really important about Christianity is that Jesus' priesthood is not the priesthood of Levi or Moses, or of Aaron, rather, because Jesus was not of the tribe of Levi. And if he wasn't of the tribe of Levi, he's certainly not from the sons of Aaron. Jesus' priesthood is the priesthood of Melchizedek, who has no lineage, either before or after in the text. And so his priesthood is of an entirely different order, an entirely different thing, because nobody, according to the law of Moses, Jesus had no right to be a priest, much less the high priest. But with the death of Jesus, the law of Moses was abrogated, and Jesus' priesthood was manifested by his self-offering to the Father, and so it's a priesthood of an entirely different type than the priesthood of the law of Moses.
It's still interesting that the Jews, they gave up on priesthood. It's, I mean, they would find, if they wanted to, they would find a way, you know, like just going around some law or whatever.
Well, yeah, but they believe that the only place that you can ever put a temple is where the original one is. You can't even put it nearby or another place. You can, if you bless it and pray. And so there's a movement for people to rebuild a temple, but even the state of Israel has never wanted that to happen because it's also sacred to Muslims and it would cause a terrible war.
That's where the mosque is.
It would cause World War III.
There is a movement. There are people because there are scriptures. There's a lot known about that. There are people that want to restore that, but that's a small. But they don't believe you can even go to Bethlehem or Nazareth or anywhere else and put. It has to be only that place.
There are ridges.
But the funny thing is they're still raising red cows.
Well, yeah, there's people and they have all the implements and they have all the...
So that's special cows that go for sacrifice?
No one...
Oh, I didn't know that. Where are they?
So they
in Israel? Yeah. And in America.
America
too? That was Sharon's thing. Are you serious? When he went up on the temple mount with his followers and started to get hot. He was part of the Third Temple movement, and I believe they got cut stones towards in order to start the foundation.
Really?
For a while, they taught this at the Pentagon, one of the hot points in the Middle East.
Mm-hmm. And you said Jerome did that?
Ariel Sharon. Yeah, there was a lot of stuff behind that when that took place.
Yeah. Actually, there's all sorts of YouTube videos about it. You just type in Third Temple or Jewish Temple, and you can see all the stuff. They've got all the stuff. They've got architectural plans. Of course, they believe that the place where the Holy of Holies was is the center of the Dome of the Rock.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyway, there's two little short paragraphs, and then we're done. Verse 37. On the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and proclaimed, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water. Now this he said about the Spirit, which those who believe in him were to receive, for as yet the Spirit had not been given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. When they heard these words, some of the people said, 'This is really the prophet.' Others said, 'This is the Christ.' But some said, 'Is the Christ to come from Galilee? Has not the scripture said that the Christ is descended from David and comes from Bethlehem, the village where David was?' So there was a division among the people over him. Some of them wanted to arrest him, but no one laid hands on him." Yeah.
Just a quick question. What does it mean that they thought someone, you said, this is the prophet? Which prophet?
Well, Moses prophesied that there would be a prophet like him who would arise. In other words, a prophet like Moses. And Jesus fulfills that. And just in the Transfiguration, you have Jesus fulfilling the prophet like Moses, the prophet like Elijah. You know, and there they are talking with him, and he's seen to be greater than both of them. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Now, remember the whole point about on the feast there would be these great processions with water.
Mm-hmm.
And so the water, I'm sure, would be either sprinkled or, you know, people would partake of it. There's even some discussion that there was a spring or water that flowed out of the Holy of Holies. Just as in Eden there was this, a river of living water. And so it's the Holy of Holies was an image, an icon, as it were, of Eden. And so it had this spring of living water flowing out of it. So Jesus identifies himself with that. And what is that living water? It's the Holy Spirit, as St. John interprets. So 40 through 43 we basically covered. They were confused. The Jews were confused. Does this make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There was one other important thing that we talked about, verse 45, the officers then went back to the chief priests and Pharisees, who said to them, "Why did you not bring him?" The officers answered, "No man ever spoke like this man." The Pharisees answered them, "Are you led astray also? Have any of the authorities or of the Pharisees believed in him? But this crowd who does not know the law are accursed." Nicodemus, who had gone to him before and who was one of them, said to them, "Does our law judge a man without first giving him a hearing and learning what he does?" They replied, "Are you from Galilee too? Search, and you will see that no prophet is to rise from Galilee." They went each to his own house, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. So Nicodemus appears again, gets himself in trouble a little bit. So, what other questions, comments?
Why couldn't Jesus Christ use simple language to communicate with the people? Why did he have to use riddles, like you said?
Well, he did so intentionally.
But what is the reason? I mean, if I spoke to you in riddles, probably you won't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
But if I spoke to you straightforward, mm-hmm. hopefully you would, right?
Right.
So what was the reason?
Well, he spoke clearly and explained himself to his disciples.
He didn't speak to the disciples in riddles?
No, he spoke clearly and explained himself. Whereas to the crowds, he spoke in riddles, and part of that is because he knew that they had eyes but could not see, and ears but could not hear, and minds but could not understand.
Was it riddles, or was it more just symbolic language?
Well,
it's symbolic language.
So it wasn't really riddles, it's just that the people couldn't understand that symbolic language.
Right.
But could this not cause misunderstanding?
Well, it did cause great misunderstanding.
So what was the point?
But it made people think about what he said.
Without understanding it.
But then, he makes it clear. Those who seek to do the will of God will understand. Those who don't seek to do the will of God, in other words, those who are after their own agenda, will not understand.
It would just be a riddle.
So,
the majority of the people did not understand it.
Yeah.
So, I'm a little bit confused,
mm-hmm.
because if I was a prophet, I would like people to understand what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
So that I could have them brought to my side.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think ultimately the underlying thing is that people can only understand by the Spirit. In other words, once their spiritual eyes have been opened, and they're given the gift of understanding. That's essentially what the scriptures say about it, because people were complaining that he was talking in parables,
mm-hmm.
And he said it's not given to them to understand.
And in a way, they had to. He had to, for them to do what they did to him.
Right.
If they understood everything, they wouldn't have killed him.
Exactly.
Well, either that or they would have killed him quicker.
It also
It's
more likely they would have killed him quicker.
Yeah.
It also kind of keeps things timeless, so you can, you know, read it in the 21st century and still try to figure out the puzzle.
Oh yeah, I mean, the 40s.
In a way, yeah.
But if it's he was speaking to the whole Jewish nation. He was speaking not only to the commoners, he was also speaking to the Jews, to the Pharisees and the Sadducees. When he spoke in parables, since they were supposed to be educated, they should have easily have caught on, because they had read the law and the prophets and the Psalms,
mm-hmm.
right?
But what he's underlining is that they're pursuing their own will, and therefore they are not able to understand. And if they would do the will of God, they would understand.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was already laid out in front of them.
It's already laid out.
So he didn't get support from the people.
He got a lot of support from the people.
Well, like when he was on the threshold, just before his crucifixion,
mm-hmm.
I understand there was a law that if only one person said that he is innocent, the trial would have started again. But there wasn't even one person
mm-hmm.
who said that he was innocent. So.
Well, that's not in the text, so I don't know. Well, Pilate said that.
But no, Pilate said not while he was standing there on
yeah.
the threshold.
While he was standing there.
Mm-hmm.
Pilate was following him.
What did
he
say?
Pilate presented him to the people and said, I find this man innocent.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But that was in his apartment, whatever.
No, that was to the people.
Well, yeah, because he asked the people, would he have the innocent him released or whoever
Barabbas. Yeah, the question is, who were the people?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's certainly not the whole
nation
there. It was the Pharisees, the Jews. You know, the leaders of the Jews.
The Romans were there too.
Yeah, but not in great numbers. They were trying to keep these rowdies, you know, peaceful. Okay. So big weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Feast of the Dormition. Okay. Anybody else? Anything else? It is truly meet to bless the Theotokos, ever blessed and most pure, and the Mother of our God, more honorable than the cherubim, more glorious beyond compared than the seraphim, who without corruption gave us birth to God the Word. True Theotokos, we magnify thee. The blessing of the Lord be upon you through his grace and love for mankind, always now and ever, into ages of ages.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.